Hello, my name is Keshwani. That's K-E-S-H-W-A-N-I, Keshwani. We are here because we want to prepare for the TEAS. We have been solving math problems out of this book here, the study manuals for the TEAS, the 6th edition. If you do not own this book already, purchase one immediately. You're going to need it. Today is our lesson number 5, day 105. The first series that I made, the first series, which was based on the math problem that appeared in the 5th edition. If you wish to have some more problems for extra practice, you will find the solutions to all the problems that appeared in this edition, the 5th edition, from day number 1 through 80. There are no videos from 81 through 100. Let's get going. Today we'll deal with the concept of converting fractions to decimal. Fractions to decimal, we are on page number 66. Here's the first problem. Part G. Problem number one, part G. We are given 19 over 10 and we have to convert this into decimal. Very straightforward, simple problem. What do we do if we have to divide a number by 10? It's very simple. If we are given a number and we have to divide that by 10, we simply pick up the decimal. Well, there is no decimal here, so we can insert our decimal here. The decimal exists right here. And since we are dividing by 10, and 10, since 10 has only one zero, we're going to pick up our decimal and move it to the left one place. And that's it. It becomes 1.9. As I said, nothing to it. What would we do if we had to divide a number by 100? Let's say, for example, 37 over 100. Now this one has two zeros, so we're going to pick up our 37, which has a decimal right here. We're going to introduce the decimal. It's not there, but we introduce it so that it's easy to deal with. And we can pick it up. And because it has two zeros, because we are dividing it by 100, we would move the decimal two spots to the left again. It becomes 0.37. 37 divided by 100 is 0.37, which would make it look better if we were to write this as 0.37. It's always a good idea to put down the leading zero. What if we were dividing by 1,000? Say, for example, 58 divided by 1,000. What would that be? Same as before. We take our 58, we introduce the decimal. It's not there, but it is there. It's there, but it's not shown because nothing comes after it. It's just zero. So we're going to introduce it so we can see it. Here is our decimal, and there is your zero. Now, we're dividing by 1,000. It has three zeros. 1, 2, 3. So we're going to pick up our decimal and move it three spots to the left. 1, 2, 3. It ends up here. It ends up here, and now we insert the zero in the empty spot. There is the empty spot here. We introduce a zero there. So the answer is 58 divided by 1,000 is simply, and now we're going to put the leading zero here, because the leading zero makes it look good. It makes it easier to see the decimal. Otherwise, the decimal might get lost in the reading. So we put our leading zero, and then the answer is 058. And this is called, as I said before, leading zero. The only purpose the leading zero serves is makes it easier, it makes it more conspicuous, it makes it more prominent, the fact that we have a decimal there. Otherwise, one might miss it, particularly if it starts out like this, without the decimal, one might read this as 37 in a hurry. So to bring their attention to the fact that it's not 37, it's 0.37, we write this as 0.37. to bring their attention to it. Let's do the next problem. That was G. Let's do H. In H we have 13 over 50. Now this is getting a little tricky. Dividing any number by 10 or 100 or 1,000 is very simple. You just move the decimal spots one place, two place, or three places, depending on whether it's 10 or 100 or 1,000 or 10,000. You just count the number of zeros and you move the decimal place to the left however many zeros you have. Very simple, very straightforward. But what do we do? What is one to do when we have something like this? It's a 50. If it were 10 or if it were 100, it would have been very easy. But then why don't we make it 100? We can't make it 10 because it's already more than 50, but we can certainly make it into 100. What can we do to the bottom? What can we do to the denominator to make the 50 into, to turn the 50 into 100? Well, it's very simple. Multiply the denominator by 2. Voila, now 50 times 2 is 100. Now it doesn't matter what's on the top, we can divide any number by 100 by moving the decimal 2 parts to the left. All done. But what we have to remember is that if you're going to increase the denominator by 2 times, if you're going to multiply the denominator by 2 times, to make sure that the value of the fraction does not change, we must do the same thing to the top. In other words, the value that is given to us, 13 over 50, whatever the value of that quantity is, 13 over 50, we have not changed it. Why is it that we haven't changed it? Because we are essentially multiplying it by 1. 2 over 2 is 1. And multiplying anything by 1 doesn't change its value. But it does make our life easier, because now we have 100 at the bottom. And now, 13 times 2 is 26, so we end up with 26. And bottom, 50 times 2 is 100. Oh, that is so much sweeter than what we were dealing with before. We are done. 26 is simply like this. As I said, introduce the point with decimals, we can see it. Decimal lies here. We are dividing it by 100. So move it 2 places to the left. We are all done. Right there. The answer is 13 over 50. Turns out that 13 over 50 is equal to 0.26. 0.26. 0.26. Always insert your leading zero. As I said, it makes it easier. Should we do one more like that? I think we should do one or two more. A little bit more challenging this time, okay? As you can see, this was a little bit more challenging than the first three we did. The first three were very simple because they were all already in the form of a 10 or 100 or 1,000. But in the exam, very rarely they will give you something as simple as that. You will see something more tricky like this one, 30 over 50, and you have to do your manipulation. Let's do one more, see what you can do with it. I'm going to give it to you, and see, you tell me what you can do with it. How about 127 over 250? Well, as you can clearly see, 250 is already more than 10. It's already more than 100. Well, what comes after 10? Well, you can have a 10 with 10, 1 with 10, or you can have 100. It's very easy to divide anything by 100. Or it's very easy to divide anything by 1,000. For example, if you have 85 over 10, that's just 8.5. 85 over 100, that's just 0.85. Or 85 over 1,000, move the decimal place 3 spots, 1, 2, 3, end up here, will simply be 0.85. As you can see, it's very easy to divide any number by 10 or 100 or 1,000 or 10 raised to any power. 10 raised to 1, or 10 raised to 2, or 10 raised to 3, anything, 1,000, 10,000, 20, not 20,000, 10,000, 100,000, a million. You just move the decimal place, however many zero you have after the 1. But the problem here is, it's already more than 10, it's already more than 100. Ah, but we can turn this into 1,000. You know how many times 250 makes 1,000? We know 25 times 4 makes 100. Watch what happens. We know 25 times the 4 makes 100, don't we? We want to turn into 1,000. Well, if you want 1,000 here, that tells me, if 25 times 4 is 100, then that tells me that 250 times a 4 must be 1,000. Because it's just, if 25 times 4 is 100, then 250 times 4 is 1,000. Let's multiply top and bottom by 4. Voila. Now we have 1,000 on the bottom. And the life is, again, very simple. 250 times 4 is 1,000. And 127 times 4 is what we have to put here. Let's find it out here. 127 times 4. 7 4s are 28. 8, carry 2. 4 2s are 8. Plus 2 is 10. 0, carry 1. 4 1s are 4 and 5. 508. Of course it's 508, because 125 times 4 is exactly 500. 125 times 4 is exactly 500. How do we know that? Well, if you have $1.25, one person has $1.25, another person has $1.25, third person has $1.25, and fourth person has $1.25, if there are four people and they all have $1.25, well, altogether they have $5, obviously. 125 times 4 is 500. We don't want 125 fours, we want 127 fours. We want two more fours. 125 fours make 500. We have 127 fours. We need two more fours, but two more fours is the 8. Anyway, so say 508 divided by 1000, we're done. All we have to do is move our decimal to the left 3 spots. So it's 508, the decimal is right here. We're going to move it to the left 3 places, because 1000 has 3 zeros. Move it to the left 3 zeros. 1, 2, 3, it ends up here. So the answer is, so the answer to our problem ball is 127 over 250, 127 over 250, when converted into decimal, becomes 0. It introduces the leading zero, 508. Follow. Let's do a couple more, shall we? Why not? Why end the video right now? Let's do a couple more, see what you can do here. Okay, let's do one more. We need to erase everything. When I put the problem on the blackboard, pause the video and see what you can do with it yourself. Here is the problem. 81 over 150. 81 over 150. I'll give you 5 seconds for you to be able to pause and unpause the video. See what you can do. Well, there's not much we can do here. Not much we can do here, because it's already more than a 10. It's more already more than 100, and it's not a 150 times. No whole number is going to give us 1000. 1000 does not divide evenly into 150. We have a problem, don't we? Well, what we could do is to see where it takes us if we will try to reduce it. Let's try to reduce it. Can we divide top and bottom by 2? Well, obviously not, because 81 is an even number. 81 is an odd number. 150 is an even number, but 81 is not. We can't divide top and bottom by 2. Well, can we divide top and bottom by 3? Do they have a common factor of 3? How do we find out if a number is divisible by 3? Do you know? A number is divisible. A number is divisible by 3 if, I'm not sure if it needs a comma there. A number is divisible by 3 if, here's the rule, if the sum of its, if the sum of its digits is divisible by 3. The rule is that if the sum of the digits of a given number is divisible by 3, then the number itself must be divisible by 3. In case you want to learn stuff, arithmetic concept of this nature, I'll give you a video that you can watch if you're interested. And the video is going to be Basic Math Day 25. Now, Basic Math is a different series. It's not the same series. It's not the same series as the series that you're watching, which has to do with T's. Just type in Basic Math Day 25. If it does not come up, if it does not pop up, then try putting in my name with it. Anytime you're searching for something, some math concept, and you're looking for some video, and if it doesn't pop up, if you're looking for my video, that is, if it doesn't pop up, type in my name first. Type in Keshwani, and then Basic Math Day 25. Watch that video. In that video, we learn what is known as divisibility rules. Divisibility rules tell us, how can we tell if a number is divisible by 2, how can we tell if a number is divisible by 3, or if a number is divisible by 4, or a 5, or a 6, or a 7, so on and so forth. Learn those rules. They are very handy in the exam. This exam, as you know, has to be taken without a calculator. So knowing these nifty tricks helps a great deal. It saves a lot of time, a lot of aggravation in the exam. For example, here, had we known this rule right away, we could have saved ourselves a lot of time talking about it. plus 1. You see, the sum of the digits of 81 is 8 plus 1. That tells us that 81 is divisible by 3. How about 150? Well, it's very clear. It's 1 plus 5 plus 0. 1 plus 5 plus 0 is 6. Both 81 and 150, they are both divisible by 3. Let's divide top and bottom by 3. Let's divide top and bottom by 3, okay? 81 over 150. Watch what happens. How many 3's does 8 have? 8 has 2 3's. 2 3's are 6. 8 has 2 3's. Listen very carefully. 8 has 2 3's. 2 3's are 6. If you have 2 3's, 1 3, 1 3, 1 3, and 2 3's. 2 3's are 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 2 3's are 6. 2 3's are 6. After we take away the 6 from the 8, we have a remainder of 2. That 2 goes and joins the 1 becomes 21. And 21 has 7 3's. Since we divided the top by 7, we must divide the bottom by 7. Sorry, since we divided the top by 3, we must divide the bottom by 3. How many 3's does 1 have? 1 has no 3's. 1 has no 3's. That 1 goes and joins the 5 and becomes 15. And 15 has 5 3's. How many 3's does 0 have? 0 has no 3's. It's just a big fat 0. It turns out that 81 divided by 150, when you reduce it by dividing top and bottom by 3, we end up with 27 over 50. Now that is helpful. Now we see the light at the end of the tunnel, because 50 can very easily be converted into 100. Of course, why not? Let's multiply this result by 2 over 2. Watch what happens. If we multiply this result by 2 over 2, one more time, the video is Basic Math, Day 25. The title is Divisibility Rules, which simply says a number is divisible by 3 if the sum of its digits is divisible by 3. And of course, 81, the sum of the digits in 81 is 8 plus 1 is 9, which is how I knew that 81 was divisible by 3. And 150 is divisible by 3 because the sum of the digits of 150 is 1 plus 5 plus 0. That's it, we're almost done. 27 times 2, well, you know, 25 twos make 50. We don't have 25 twos, we have 27 twos. We need 2 more twos, 2 twos are 4. So 25 times 2 would have been 50, is 54. 54 over 50 times 2, 25 times 2 is 54, 50 times 2 is 100, and we are done. It's simply, here's our 54, since we are dividing it by 100, since we are asked to divide by 100, 100 has 2 zeros, we're going to pick up our decimal, move it 2 spots, voila. That's the answer, 0.54. The answer is 0.54. In other words, we were asked, what is 81 over 150 in decimal? The answer is 0.54. But of course, in real life, we wouldn't have done all of this nonsense. These days, we just reach for the calculator, we would have known it in jiffy. Just divide 81 by 150 on the calculator, and you will see that it gives you 0.54. But in the exam, they expect you to do this thing by hand. They expect you to show them that you understand these concepts, that you understand how to do basic elementary manipulation of numbers. And that's how you do it. So one more time, we had 81 over 150, we divided top and bottom by 3, we got 27 over 50. We multiply top and bottom by 2 of that result. We do so that we have 50 times 2 at the bottom, which is 100. 27 times 2 is 54, and 54 divided by 100 is 0.54. Well, end of the story. See if you can do the next one. Now that you understand the concept, if you cannot divide top and bottom by 2, if either the denominator or the numerator is an odd number, or they are both odd numbers, then obviously you can't reduce them by 2. Try 3 next. Try the 3 next before you worry about anything else. Let's see if you can do the next one. Here's the number. Here are the numbers. 237 over 750. Well, it turns out that the bottom is an even number. The denominator is an even number. We can divide denominator by 2, but numerator is not an even number. It is not a multiple of 2. So they have no common factor of 2. We have to try 3 then. Let's see if they're divisible by 3. Well, 237 is made up of 2, 3, and 7. 3, of course, we know is divisible by 3, so we don't have to waste our time looking at that. 3 plays no role. In other words, 3 plays no role in determining whether or not 237 is divisible by 3. The only two digits that are going to play a role the only two digits that are going to play any role in determining whether or not 237 is divisible by 3 are 2 and 7. And 2 plus 7 is 9. If you wanted to, you could do 2 plus 3 is 5, 5 plus 7 is 12, and 12 is divisible by 3, and therefore 237 is divisible by 3. But as I said, 3 plays no role. We just have to look at 2 plus 7, 2 plus 7 is 9, which tells us that the top is divisible by 3. Similarly, at the bottom, 7 plus 5 is 12, and 12 is divisible by 3. We can divide top and bottom by 3. Let's do that, shall we? Before we do that, before we divide top and bottom by 2, see if you can tell me the number that I'm about to put on the blackboard is going to be divisible by 3 or not. Okay, here we go. We're going to create a number, and I'm telling you right now that the number is going to be divisible by 3 because we're going to design in such a way. We're going to design it from the very beginning. By design, the number that we're going to put on the blackboard at the end is going to turn out to be divisible by 3. Watch what happens. 1 and 2. Obviously, 1 plus 2 is 3. That is divisible by 3 because we're going to look at the sum of the digits at the end. How about, so that's the 3, let's do 6. How about 2 and 4, or 2 plus 4 is 6. That's divisible by 3. So we have 3, we have a 6, let's do 9 this time. How about 6 and 3? 6 and 3? I don't like a 6 and 3, because 6 and 3, they are both individually divisible by 3. 6 is divisible by 3, 3 is divisible by 3. It's not interesting. But we need 9. How about 4 and 5? 4 and 5, voila. And let's stick a 3 in the middle. There we go. 3, of course, we know is divisible by 3. 4 plus 5 is 9. Those two digits are going to be divisible by 3 when you look at these two digits. 2 and 4 is 6 because we're looking at the sum of the digits. And as you can see, the way we design it, we are forcing the sum to be divisible by 3. We are forcing the sum of the digits to be divisible by 3 because that's how we created it. So if somebody were to ask us, is 1,243,542 divisible by 3? What's the question? The question is 1,243,542 divisible by 3? The theory dictates that we add up the digits. We look at the sum of all the digits. But that's just the theory. In practice, you can cheat. We can cheat. For example, watch what happens here. For example, you can clearly see a 1 and a 2. Well, 1 and 2 add up to 3. These two digits are not going to play any role in determining whether or not 1,243,542 is going to be divisible by 3. What else do you see? Oh, we see a 3. Of course, 3 is divisible by 3. That's not going to play any role in determining whether or not the number is divisible by 3. Oh, I see a 5 and a 4. 5 and a 4, 5 plus 4 is 9. Those two are not going to play any role in determining whether or not 1,243,542 is divisible by 3. We're left with 4 and a 2. And 4 plus 2 is 6. Ah, this number is evenly divisible by 3. Of course, it's evenly divisible by 3 because we forced it to be divisible by 3 from the very beginning. Let's divide top and bottom by 3, shall we? Here we go. How many 3s does 2 have? 2 has no 3s. 2 has no 3s. Oh, sorry, I shouldn't have crossed it out. We shouldn't have crossed it out. We do not cross it out. We only cross it out if we are able to use it. We are unable to use it, so it's going to go to the next slide. Let's start again. We're going to divide top and bottom by 2. How many 2s? Are we going to divide top and bottom by 3, rather. How many 3s does 2 have? 2 has no 3s. 2 is too puny to have any 3s. It's too puny to have any 3s. So what does he do? Well, he goes to his next door neighbor and says, look, I'm too puny. I can't take on 3 by myself. Why don't we join forces? And his neighbor says, sure, why not? Let's become 23. You can't take him on your own. Let's work together. They become 23. How many 3s does 23 have? 23 has 7 3s. 7 3s are 21. 7 3s are 21. After we take away 21 from 23, we have a remainder of 2. That 2 goes and joins the 7, becomes 27 again. And 27, I shouldn't say 27 again because it wasn't 27 to begin with before. Yeah, here it was 23. It becomes 27 and 27 has 9 3s. So we have divided the top by 3. Let's divide the bottom by 3. How many 3s does 7 have? 7 has 2 3s. 2 3s are 6. After we take away 6 from the 7, we have a remainder of 1. That 1 goes and joins the 5, becomes a 15. 15 has 5 3s. How many 3s does 0 have? 0 has no 3s. Which makes perfect sense. Of course, we knew from the very beginning that 250 times 3 is 750. So now we are left with 79 over 250. 679/250. Now in the event that you are still a little confused as to how I'm dividing, I'm going to show you this division, not the paraman. I'm not going to do both. I'm going to show you the top division, the long hand, the babyish way. Let's do it babyish way. 237. We want to divide it by 5. Okay, we want to divide it by 5 and watch what happens. Watch what happens. We're going to divide again 1 by 5, 237. And this time, you're going to understand the language. 237. How many 5 does 2 have? 2 has no 5. 2 has no 5. 2 is too puny to have any 5. So what does he do? Well, he goes to the 3, his neighbor, he joins up a 3 and becomes a 23. So he joins the 3 and becomes a 23. How many 5 does 23 have? Well, 23 has 4 5s. 23 has 4 5s. 4 5s are 20. 4 5s. Why am I dividing by 5? We are dividing by 3. Blast it. We're supposed to divide by 3. Bloody hell. How many 3's does 2 have? 2 has no 3's. 2 has no 3's. What does he do? He goes and joins the 3 and becomes 23. And how many 3's? We're dividing by 3 here. How many 3's does 23 have? 23 has 7 3's. 23 has 7 3's. 7 3's are 21. 7 3's are 21. And if it's going to confuse you, this curly line at the bottom to join them, I'm going to raise it. We draw this curly line. We draw this curly line to bring our attention to the fact that they have joined forces. They're together now. But here we're not going to do it because it's going to cause confusion. After we take away 21 from the 23, we have a remainder of 2. What does that 2 do? Well, that 2 goes, the remainder of 2, we have a remainder of 2, that 2 goes and joins the 7 and becomes 27. That 2 goes and joins the 7 and becomes a 27. And 27 has 9 3's. 9 3's are 27. 27 has 9 3, 9 3's are 27. And that's where the story ends. Question is, what are we going to do with it? Well, what can we possibly do with it? It's more than 10. It's more than 100. Can we somehow convert this into 1,000? The answer is yes. We know 250 times 4 is 1,000. We know that 250 times 4 is 1,000. So if you were to multiply top and bottom of this result by 4, we can go someplace. Let's multiply top and bottom by 4. And watch what happens. I'm going to raise this thing. We need the room. Well, bottom already we know. 250 times 4 is 1,000. That was the whole point. That's why we did it. So bottom is 1,000. What do we have on the top? 79 times 4. 9 4s are 36, 6, carry 3. 7 4s are 28, 28 plus 3 is 31. Voila! So we end up with 316/1,000. 316/1,000. Here is our 316. We're going to introduce the decimal. And now, it's very simple. We are done. We're dividing by 1,000. 1, 2, 3. 1,000 has 3 zeros. So we're going to pick up our decimal, move it 3 spots. 1, 2, 3, and it ends up here. In other words, the question was, how much is 237 divided by 750? The answer is 237 divided by 750 turns out is exactly equal to 0.316. That's all. We're done. That's all I have for today. Let's see what we have for tomorrow, the next video. Next video, we'll do the problem that you see, the problem number 2 and 3. And then the following video, we'll go on the next page, where we'll talk about PEMDAS, the order of operation. And that's the idea. We're going to go through page by page. We're going to learn the concept thoroughly. We're not just going to do one or two problems that they give you in the book. We're going to do a couple of more problems just to get some extra practice. And I'm going to give you some additional video to watch that will help you get some more exercise. For example, as I told you before already, we have solved every single problem from this book. And if you want more exercises, if you want more practice, watch day number 16, 17, and 18. Just type in T's, day 16, 17, and 18. On those days, 16, 17, and 18, we did the problems dealing with the concept of decimal, fraction, and percentage. How to go back and forth between decimal, percentage, and fractions. 16, 17, and 18, okay? Bye now.